Hello folks, so in these next couple of lectures we will be talking about this very fun and evolving and exciting topic of chip packaging, or more specifically IC chip packaging, or packaging of integrated circuits. And this is a very exciting and evolving field. Shown in this image here are pictures of different packages of chips. So if you have taken any digital electronics class, or if you have done any do-it-yourself electronics project, you might, these images might already be very familiar to you. This is a dual inline package, or a DIP package, which is if you have done ever inserted chips into a breadboard, it's usually these kind of packages. And for any amateur electronics, you might have already been familiar with this package, which is a quadruple flat package, or QFP. So it has chips, it has these pins coming out from all four directions. That's why it's quadruple. And this chip packaging world is full of acronyms, three letter or four letter acronyms defining these different packages. And so I won't boggle you down with all the acronyms, but we will talk about a few of those in the next couple of videos. So to give you some historic context, this is how packaging was defined in the late 80s or 90s. So this is a definition of packaging taken from a handbook of packaging back in the late 80s. And essentially a package for a chip used to have four major functions, and this is still true today. So it would have four major functions. One would be to distribute power lines, so bring in the voltage supply and bring in the current required for the functioning of the chip. Distribute the signal both coming in and going out of the chip. Then the next function would be to take out the heat which is dissipated in this chip and distribute it outside. And the other thing is to protect your chip, most importantly from earlier it used to be from from the environment, from the heat. Nowadays it's becoming more about protect it from electromagnetic radiation coming in and so on. So another way to define packaging would be that it's a means of connecting features on your transistors, which are on the order of full dimensions, are in the order of a few nanometers, to features on your package, which are on the order of dimensions of few millimeters. So it's a way to bridge these dimensions from a nanometer scale to a millimeter scale. So it's a way to bridge these dimensions over a six order change in magnitude. To be very honest, there was not too much action happening in the field of packaging back in, until the last decade. The IC world had become very flat. So it would function like Jensen Huang from NVIDIA would design a chip. He would call up Morris Chang from TSMC to run these wafer lots for him and make these chips. And they will ship these wafer lots to a packaging house somewhere in the Asia. In this case, Ibiden, which is a big packaging house located in Philippines. And they would, dice these chips and put them into nice packages, and they will ensure that the sale happens in Philippines, so they save on tax. But there was not too much action happening in the packaging level, which was had become a very bottom layer in this IC food chain. So most of the profits would be stored with the design house and the place where the chips were manufactured, and the packaging house will get a very small share of the overall action. But this has changed quite rapidly in the last 5-6 years. So packaging nowadays, it's besides that four functions that I defined earlier, it is increasingly seen as a way to improve your overall system performance. And it's also seen a way, especially in your mobile devices, in your iPhones and your iPads, you want all these chips to fit in a very small form factor. So you want essentially all your chips to fit in a very small form factor. So whenever you hear terms like performance and form factor, immediately dollar signs should start popping up in front of your eyes. So that's why a lot of action is actually now moving into the field of packaging. I can name at least 20 startup companies which are active in the field of packaging. Even the bigger companies, they want to play and they want an action of this pie too. And so there's a lot of action happening in the field of packaging, and I'll touch upon some of that in the next few lectures. To give you some more context on how advanced the packaging has become, so this image shows here an old desktop computer that I had bought in 2001. And shown below here is the guts of this computer or the motherboard. And you can see the microprocessor. It has this big fan on the top. You can see different chips soldered together, and you can see this, you know, quadruple package, and you can see these chips soldered together. This is a graphics chip from NVIDIA, and clearly you can identify the, you know, the solderings of these different chips. There are some expansion slots here, so you can plug in different cards in here. You can plug in extra memory if you want. And there are other elements like capacitors, inductors, and so on. And nowadays, you can fit this entire computer in this small PCB, which is here I've compared it with the size of a H1 pencil. So you can fit in almost all of the functionality and processing power and computing power in this small PCB. So a large part of that is enabled by the Moore's law of chips, you know, becoming smaller and faster, but there's a major role which has been played by the packaging technology as well. So packaging has played a big role in enabling this form factor as well. So what I want to show next here is that these changes in packaging, or these changes in packaging, has always been dictated by the increase in the pin count. So many of you might remember these dip packages, which were, you know, are still used by hobby electronics, or if you take up a digital electronic class in the electrical engineering department, you'll be using these kind of packages. But there's only in this dual inline packages, if you have pins on both sides, there's only certain number of pin count that you can go to. After that, essentially you need to either, you know, your pins will start to collapse, or it won't function as well. So to the next evolution of that, which some of you might still have seen, are these quadruple flat packages where you have chips, where you have pins coming out from all four sides. And so that took us, you know, even further. That took us to 200, or, you know, up to 250 pins. And if you open up old desktop computer, you will still see a lot of chips which are of this QFP kind of packages soldered to your motherboard. So why does the pin count keeps on increasing? So there are multiple reasons for that. One simple reason is that as you move from, say, an 8-bit to a, let's think about, you know, in terms of a microprocessor. So in a microprocessor, if you move from 8 bits to 16 bits to 32 bits to 64 bits, you now need more and more of these pins to communicate with your memory. So if you're communicating with your DRAM, you now need, you know, 64 into 2, because each line for each signal you need one reference line and one ground line and the signal line. So you need more and more lines, more and more pins to communicate if you're moving, if you're increasing the bit size of your microprocessor, especially if you're moving more functionality. Say you are moving more and more functionality into a system on chip, you again need signals coming in from your analog chips, like your accelerometer, your gyroscope in your phone, your all the analog devices, signals from those coming into your microprocessors. And so the pin count, it has been consistently increasing, and that has driven these change in packages from a dual inline package to a quadruple flat package. And now what is used most commonly is this ball grid array, or BGA package. And what it entails is these grid of solder balls, which are placed on below your chip. And you would put this together, you would flip this and put this on your PCB, and you'll have these grid of these balls which we'd be connecting, which would be routing all your connections from your PCB into your chip. And essentially, this so we went from IOs on two sides to IOs on all four sides, and there's so much you can achieve by just being on the perimeter. And now we are essentially moving to IOs all over this area. And as I'll show you, it will soon require moving IOs to, to a 3D in a third dimension very soon.